Welcome to Torah Talk, a Torah Institute podcast.
Torah just means instruction in Hebrew. At Torah Talk, we will make straight the ways of Yahuwah and discuss the simple truths of Scripture so that even you can understand and get all the juicy life hidden within the pages of Yahuwah's Torah. Welcome to Torah Talk with Lou White and Mark Davidson.
It's the Torah Zone.
Hey, brother.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Well, fine. I bet you're so tired. You must. the work that I've seen just in the last couple of days has blown all of our minds.
Yeah, it's been a full-on week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, the first day of Sukkah. This is
yes. It. How'd it go for you, man?
Oh, we were out there blowing the shofar, my shofar, and Adam's shofar last night. And we saw people coming out of their house, looking around, going, "What?" You know, neighbors down the street. You know, and they may not have seen us because we were in the dark.
Yeah. Ah, cunning.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brothers and sisters, welcome to Torah Talk. We're into episode 11 now, I think, and it's the first day of Sukkoth, 2011.
Yes, wonderful.
Yeah. We had a little camping experience last night. I took the boys out into a tent, and best you can at their age, and get them used to the camping life. And they just were high as kites. They loved it.
Yeah. I was made aware, I've heard this before, but it was a Native American, it was here in this continent, the North American natives who were misinterpreted by the settlers, like Columbus called, well, I don't even know that he was on this continent, but he did discover Santo Domingo, an island area, but the natives were misinterpreted as being Indians because he thought he was in India. Because he had expectations of finding India. Anyway, these natives were called Indians by mistake, and that name stuck. But one of the terms that they use, because they are of the lost tribes of Israel, is some food that they ate during the Feast of Sukkah, or Sukkoth. And it was called succotash. Succotash was a vegetable meal that they cooked during that festival, and it's a word that is stuck. People assumed that it was a Native American word, but then the derivations from the Hebrew language and the time that it's eaten makes it connect with the festival of Sukkah, or Sukkoth.
Wow.
Isn't that fun?
So there's evidence, again, that...
there's more. Mm. Yeah, it's amazing, you know.
Wow.
Of course, I haven't delved into all the details, but there's something like 1,400 or 1,500 words that are spoken by the Native American tribes that actually derive from Hebrew roots.
Wow.
So where are we today?
We're in a lovely garden.
Oh.
And there's a sukkah. Cool. There's a sukkah in the background. Do you like it? It's got all these brambles and... things in the background. You've just gone out of focus.
I'm out of focus. Am I back?
Yep, you're back now.
Okay, I can't get too far away.
Okay, you have to stay there. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lovely sukkah behind you. Yeah, vines growing all over it, and lovely plants and trees and shrubs around it. Lovely.
That's awesome. Yeah.
First day of Sukkah.
Yes. So how many festivals of Sukkoth have you observed?
Well, this is the first year we've actually attempted to put a structure up It's just a couple of my dad's old tents, but just for the boys' sake, just to get them used to it. We still haven't gone to get the, we were just clamoring for time. We haven't got the tree yet we've just got a tent. But
little thin, small branches, you know.
Yeah, but we figure we've got about 8 days to get this right, so we're getting
there.
In Zechariah 14, I believe it is, it says, you know, during in the world to come, when Yahushua has returned, all the Gentile nations are going to have to, under compulsion, observe the Festival of Sukkah and come by some ambassadors or representatives to Jerusalem and observe the Festival of Sukkoth. You know, Zechariah 14, I think. I don't know what verse it is. It's, around 15 or 16. It starts out talking about that.
Yeah.
And it's, that's a wonderful thing. And, it's obviously in the world to come. It's a future event. So it would be interesting for us to be rehearsing now. You know, we need to be rehearsing. So, you know, you're in Australia and we're in North America. Obviously, we've been scattered. And we love what we want to do it.
Yeah.
It's like we want to, he said, I think it was Deuteronomy, Debaran, chapter 4. He said that when these words come upon you in the latter days, then you will return to his Torah and obey his voice. You know, and he didn't say we'd come back to the land at that time, but he said you would obey his voice wherever we had been scattered to, you know. And, you know, the word scattered in the sense of scattering has everything to do with the word sukkah. Sukkah means a tent or a tent dweller, and the scattered ones is found in the word Scotland, which is also understood in the ancient tongue as Scuthland, the land of the scattered ones. And even in their, I think they have a constitution, and I don't have much detail on that, but they actually, in their constitution, discuss how many years it had been since they were scattered at the time they founded their constitution. So they know who they are. You know, Israelites, you know.
I was talking to Chris the other day, and he was saying it was amazing that the fact that during this festival of Sukkoth, it's about the temple and him dwelling in us. Well, since the temple has been destroyed, the temple is now us. So he now dwells in us. And he was talking along those lines, just how amazing it is, the concept of Yahusha dwelling, because, I mean, that's the whole symbolism of the dwelling, as far as we understood it.
Yeah.
And he dwells in us. He's come to dwell in us physically, and then he's now in us, which we just thought was amazing.
It is, and that makes us his body, he being the head. But you see, a lot of the terminology gets a little muddled in the mind of a Christian because they identify themselves as Christians. But really, what's happened is they are Israelites. They're actually, his body is named Israel. And they use this term spiritual Israel for Christianity, which is not exactly something that's found in Scripture. That's something that they want to relate to because they see a physical Israel as being the Jews, but the spiritual Israel as being the Christians. And that's not true. It's actually the Christians or Gentiles must engraft into Israel and become true Israelites and obey all the same laws and or instructions. So they become actual Israel. You know, it isn't spiritual. It is spiritual, but it's physical too, you know.
Yeah.
No distinction made. He says in the word, there is not to be a distinction made between a native born or one that was derived in the lineage from a foreigner who engrafted in too. And there's no distinction at all, you know. So, and yet, you know how they do. They try to build those walls up. And, you know, the dividing wall, like, this is for these people over here, and they can't come in here. They put the signs up and warn them. It's a death penalty. you know, see, this has been shattered, you know.
Yeah.
Now all we have to do is just say, well, we're going to keep the same commandments. You know, he even said that. He said, go and teach them everything that I commanded you to obey. And how clear is that? You know, it's just great. It makes you feel like it's much simpler than it really they make it complicated, you know.
They make it so complicated.
Yeah.
It's amazing to me. My brother-in-law is a seminary-trained pastor, or he's a under second-in-charge pastor, whatever you call it. And he won't have anything to do with me. He considers my family and I a heretic, deluded, all those sort of words. My parents have been trying to smooth it over so that the family can just, you know, be amiable. But I had an experience last weekend because no one was home at my parents' house, but I ran into him. And we're not allowed in his house, we're not allowed near him, because there's a scripture somewhere he claims that if somebody falls away from Christ, that you don't have anything to do with them. And I said, well, you know, so I thought, I took this opportunity, I thought, okay, I'll go here, see what he has to say, try and smooth it over. And I said, you do realize that we have the same Messiah, mate, you know? Because in the past, we'd sort of promoted, and it was kind of, you know, a different slant on it. We were sort of saying, you know, JESUS is very different to Yahushua, you know, and a lot of that may be true, but I was trying to say to him, look, it's the same scriptures to an extent. It's the same Messiah. We've just discovered it. He's got a different name, you know, and we didn't know that. And he's saying, no, it's blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, and you this and that. And I said, do you know what that blasphemy against the Spirit is? It's, you know, declaring that something that is of Yahushua's spirit is a demon. I said, I'm not saying that, you know. And he was trying to draw me into discussions about trinities and about this and that and all sorts of things. And I'm trying to stay out and say, look, I just want to come here and say, look, I love you, mate, and I'm sorry for the things that have gone down. And we've made some stupid decisions along the way and said things we shouldn't have said. But I said, the whole goal of Scripture, as we see it, is just love, you know. And I said, you're welcome in my home any time. The kids can play, whatever you want to do. But I said, you don't want anything to do with this. And I said, is that love? Or? And, no. He said, I said, Yahushua's greatest commandment was to love one another. No. His greatest commandment was to love him first. And I'm loving him by acknowledging that, you know, don't have anything to do with people that have fallen away from Christ. You know, you once knew him and now you're denying him and all this sort of thing. I said, well, okay, that's fine, mate. And you know how it plays when it's your own family. It's really, really cuts you to the heart. And but a couple of days later, then this whole witchcraft song came along and I just went off nuts into that. And what you're saying about the anointing and everything, you just wake up the next morning and you just go, I just feel like I've been in a trance. You just go, I'm listening to this song going, this is just madness. It's just insane. And where was I? And then you were saying, and I was speaking to Chris about it, and he said, well, everything you went through over the weekend, the pressure and the hideous feeling, he said, look what Yahushua's given you. You know, he just, and you don't feel like it was you, do you? I said, not at all. I don't record stuff like that, you know. And he said, this is what he does. And you were saying in your emails as well, it's such a blessing to be able to be used like that, you know. So that was just an insane week for me.
Now, for the people that don't understand this, he's talking about the way that Yahuwah comes into you and uses you like a vessel and to do a specific thing. And then when he gets done with you, you go, wow, where'd that come from? And you feel this incredible exhaustion, but yet a peace and a joy having been used in such a powerful way to be creative. And, you know, he's reaching out through this, what looks like evil. It's really intended to not reach us. It's intended from a worldly viewpoint, and it also shows his viewpoint of these things too. But the people that are engaged in witchcraft, the kind of witchcraft they identify with in the movies and in reality now, they're actually going to be drawn into this, the people that are attracted to it, and they're going to be exposed to the truth. And in the lyrics that you put up on the screen, that's going to really help them understand what they're really involved in. That they're being deceived, and that, you know, this witchcraft thing, the song that you've recorded is just amazing. And a lot of the people that are members of the body are going to be attacking us and criticizing us for that song because of the darkness. Yeah. But you see, they have to understand, it's not for them, it's for the world. And we're sent to the world. As a lot of people that have criticized and attacked me, they don't realize that we are actually in the in a spiritual war. And that and everybody's not equipped to do the same thing. You know, so we can't look at each other and say, whoa, what's that? What are you doing? Why are you speaking to those people? And, you know, that's who we're sent to. You know, and it's from that group of people that we're sent to, a small remnant is going to be drawn out. And they're precious. Not only to us, we have to love the redeemed. And that's where your brother-in-law comes in. If he doesn't love the redeemed, the blood of Messiah is on him, and that's what we see. And we say, well, you've been redeemed by the same blood. How can you not love the others that were redeemed by that same blood? You know, it's just misunderstanding and semantics. It's the words that we use. And even among the Nazarene, we are highly critical of one another over how we spell the name, you know, in our Latin letters. It's just not right.
Yeah. Well, I speaking about the witchcraft, I sent a couple of those reactions that you guys had to the song. I sent them through to Chris and Victoria in Queensland, and they sent me back this email. I want to read it because some of the stuff that they just discovered as well is just absolutely hideous. They said, that's incredible, mate. See how people really feel about your work. People who can see and understand. They are the ones to listen to, and Satan hates what you are doing because people are being awakened and saved. So keep going. And then he says, we just saw on the daily news that children are being abducted from Africa, taken to the UK to be sold for the purposes of witchcraft. Apparently, they cut off their arms and legs, head and genitals. Then they collect the blood and sell it to people to put it in their houses to ward off evil spirits. They said the smell of the blood was so bad that you could only slightly open the container. They said that this blood is becoming so popular for all sorts of remedies. The authorities saved over 400 kids who were smuggled in the last year, but this is only a drop in the ocean as to how many are not saved. Imagine this happening to children that we know. And then he says, keep your eyes on your boys, I reckon. Apparently people are going to these witch doctors in the civilized countries of the UK, and the highest and most powerful remedy is the blood of the children. They interviewed a witch doctor who said that he had contacts all over the world and they know where they can abduct these kids. How disgusting and amazing that this is on the evening news and all they did was report the situation. Then they go on to the next bit of gossip and then a happy commercial. Isn't that? And Amy was reading that to me while we were driving and she was just so upset. That's just happening to the children. And you don't even want to think about it, you know. It's just, that's going on. I just thought I'd tie that in with witchcraft.
Well, I had known that there were secret sacrificial offerings of children and abductions many decades ago. You know, I'd heard about it, and the activities of people practicing different forms of witchcraft were abducting children and going into forests and torturing them, and, you know, using their blood. And, you know, and it's just, It's just off the charts. I can't believe it. But, yeah, and the pagans were offering the children of the unwanted pregnancies that occurred in the pagan temples, you know, many of them. And then parents generally, too, would come and give their children that they didn't really love. They just offered them. And it's a particular one that maybe had a problem, you know, a slow one or one that had physical ailments, defects that they didn't want to deal with, you know. Today, abortion is a means of, one of the means of eugenics. You know, they're not calling it eugenics or, you know, ethnic cleansing. There's a lot of terms for it, but the globalists or the superclass wants to reduce the population of the planet from around 6 billion down to around a manageable 300 million, which means about 95% of the people have to go. And of course, I think that's what Scripture is talking about with the horses. You know, the pale horse is probably biological. The black horse is probably famine, you know, and red horse is probably war. But wars, they can kill people, but they're not going to be able to kill people enough, even if they are thermonuclear. But, of course, Yahusha did say that if there had not been a shortening of the days, that no flesh would be saved, and that would be biological and famine and wars and thermonuclear weapons, no doubt. And he, when he said no flesh, I think he meant animals too. You know, there's going to be a huge reduction in the population of this planet at some point. And they've been planning this for at least 50 years. You know, and the food thing is going to be probably a global thing too, just like this economic circumstances is all over the earth. Well, they can do the same thing with the food because they suck up all the money. See, the United Nations has a World Bank. The World Bank is a branch of the United Nations. And from that come out all the Federal Reserve Banks in all the countries. And they can just vacuum up the funds. And then they say, there's an inflation. And, well, the inflation is all the money that's being spent is actually sucked into the banks. And, you know, they're the superclass is taking the money. And they're not spending it. But they possess it. But what they don't know is, everything that's happening, it's going to happen to the population of the earth. It's going to be the same for them. Because the famine that they're going to create is you know, going to affect them too. But they think they're going to escape that. It's really sad, yeah. So the things that we're going to see that are coming upon this earth in this next few, well, maybe, I don't know how soon it's going to start, but it's already started, really. The earthquakes, the famines, everybody can find out about that. It's going to move from the third world countries to the second world countries to the first world countries. And the first world countries are where we live. So food prices are already on the rise. The super class wants to do something about what they term as the useless eaters, the people that are useless, and they're just consuming the resources of the planet. And they want to reduce their numbers. But what were you going
to
say?
You were saying it's wise to for people to stockpile food to an extent, but it's not really, there's not a lot you can really do. We rely on Yahusha's protection, Yahusha's protection, don't we?
Exactly. Stockpiling enough food for, if you could, up to a month, you know, that would be fine. Anything beyond that would probably be useless anyway. Because when the madness starts, it's going to get so bad that people are going to be eating their own children. And they'll be, you know, furrowing around in the neighborhoods and running around and trying to, you know, once the gasoline runs out, though, in a matter of weeks, nobody will be able to travel great distances. But there probably will be a lot of group gangs, and they'll just take advantage of the weaker people, you know. That's why it's important that if it ever in our lifetime gets that bad, we must escape to you know, less populated areas. So we can get as far away from the cities as we can. Like Yahushua said, flee to the mountains, which I understand is flee to the nations. Get out of the land of Israel, in other words, because Israel is going to be pounded hard with not only, you know, the enemies of Israel, but by the plagues that are going to be unleashed, you know, in a day of vengeance. And when he says that the blood is going to flow up to the horses' bridles, he really means that. There's going to be armies marching into that land. And I don't know if they, I guess they're going to be discovered, they have discovered some oil there. And that's a wonderfully encouraging thing, but it could be something that would trigger, you know, even more the greed in the Arab nations that might want to take Israel for that reason too. For some reason, they think they've already possessed it and it was taken away from them. And that's really odd, because all they have to do is read history and they can see that, you know, the Philistines were there and part of the land in Gaza, and they weren't Philistines. The Arabs were not Philistines. You know, they were in the loins of Abraham, or, you know, as far as the Ishmaelites. You know, if Abraham came from Chaldea, then, you know, he's traveling to this land that Yahuwah is showing him, and he sees the Philistines, Abraham and Ishmael and Ishak, you know, or Isaac, they're his kin. So what do the Philistines have to do with it? You know, the Philistines that were there, you can't be saying, well, we've got to find these Philistines. Where are they? Let's give the land back to them. They only had a little coastal area anyway around Gaza. But, you know, the land was, you know, filled with all these pagans doing these horrible things with children. Just like we see the witchcraft you're describing in Britain, it's happening everywhere. But Britain and the United States are very, very big areas of this activity. And they were doing the same thing in the land, what we call Israel today. The pagans were doing that very same thing. It's witchcraft, you know. It's practicing ancient religion.
There's even a new cosmetic service you can get now, which the guys up north saw advertised. It's called the vampire treatment, and it's Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie and Kylie, they're all into it. They go and they extract your own blood and then pump it into certain parts of your own face, and it's fantastic, apparently. It's got some technical name, but everybody's calling it the vampire treatment. And we're just like, oh my goodness. And the ads are just black, and there's this woman with red lips and blood and these vampire teeth, and we're just like, oh, insane. And on the next page, they've got this psychic festival coming next week. And all the kids are there going, yeah, yeah, we'll be there. And we're just like, oh dear. How far is
it
going? It's
insane. There's zombies and, Halloween is, enough. It should be for the pagans, but it's going all around the whole calendar now. The zombie things, I talked about that, the walking dead, the living dead, whatever. And, of course, this thing that you're talking about, vampires. The vampires have been going on here in our city for, I don't know, 15 years, I guess. You know, the people that drink blood and they look like they dye their hair into this dark black stain. And, of course, the black lips, you know, and the white skin, you know.
Gothic.
Yes. It's bizarre, you know.
I wanted to ask you from last week's show, I had a couple of conversations about, you were saying the speed of light would have been continuous in the garden. And they'd say, what does that mean? I'll try to explain what you were saying, and now the speed of light is slowing down. But I really didn't get what you were sort of saying, what the repercussions of that would have been in the garden itself, like the speed of light was continuous.
Well, I think what I was saying was the speed of light was instantaneous, yeah. Meaning it went in the universe that Yahuwah created. The light, speed of light would have been instantaneous throughout the universe. It wouldn't have had any time frame, where today we measure it at around 300,000 kilometers per second. It takes one light second for light to reach the moon, for example, or come to the Earth from the moon. You know, so a laser beam that we fire at the moon takes a 1 second to reach the moon. But in some theoretical studies, the people have surmised that the speed of light could have at one time been much, much higher, which would distort the age of the universe as people scientifically, so to speak, interpret the universe's age. And if the speed of light were, say, 10 times faster, that the universe would be 10 times younger, you know, in their interpretation. Because they're basing their theories of the age of the universe on the speed of light as it is now.
Oh, I thought they were always basing it on fossils and things like that.
Well, that isn't the age of the universe, so to speak, necessarily. They're misinterpreting the age of the fossils as well, because they're when you look at the techniques that they use for trying to interpret the age of something, they usually have to see, they have to know where it came from, how far down it was, and what approximate guess the finder would ascertain this thing to be. And when they do these carbon-14 tests, they understand too that there's a lot of room for error, you know, a great amount of room for error. When they say, when they tested this one, they tested a living squirrel tail. I mean, the tail of this squirrel was chopped off. And then they handed it to the carbon-14 tester. And they found it to be tens of thousands of years old based upon the carbon-14 process. And it just isn't accurate.
Wow.
But the gullible will accept whatever they're told because they're scientists, you know. They don't make mistakes.
So for the speed of light to be instantaneous, how do you reckon that would have affected the garden? And do you think it would have been shinier, or just what physical repercussion do you think that would?
Well, I don't know how it would manifest itself. We can't even imagine. But if it was a fall, the fall from what? You know, a dimensional fall, more than likely. The ability for Adam and Kuah to see things in a certain way. And, you know, some of the things that we read about in the New Jerusalem, where there's gold that is transparent, you know. Well, that's because light will be changed in some way. Maybe the physical properties of the thing itself as well. Us being able to see through walls and go through physical objects will also be possible in our new bodies. So, yeah, and light would, of course, be affected as well, because the whole universe is groaning and it's decaying, you know, it's breaking down. And we don't really know what it would be like to have all that repaired, you know, and perfection to be restored. But the garden was actually probably, you know, as far as they knew, had no end. So there was a boundless area as far as space, but they may have been in an environment that was just completely alien to what we understand as a garden. And of course, the word garden in Scripture is describing a farm, you know, a place where there's plants and animals, and they're caretaker. The caretaker is the farmer, you know, the farmer himself. It just reminded me the popular classical artist, Beethoven, or composer, his very name actually means farmer, beet farmer, you know, Beethoven. That's kind of fun. So when we read the word garden, we're really talking about a farm, you know. What was that place? Yeshayahu, or Isaiah, chapter 66, talks about the garden, that the Gentiles go into the gardens, that means farms, and they choose from what they want to eat, you know, the rat, the pig, and all this stuff. And he says that he's going to bring an end to them for having done this, you know, eating the wrong things. He's going to destroy them. And he said there would be a great many people that would be destroyed for that one reason, you know, that they just sanctify or set themselves apart to go into the gardens and eating the flesh of pigs, you know, which are loaded with toxins. And, you know, you go into a dining establishment now and you see them selling things like lobsters and shrimp. And they're acting like these are really wonderful things. But actually, these things eat dead matter. The shrimp goes down into the sand, and it eats decaying matter from the... It's like the litter box of the sea. You know, yeah. All the dead... You know, the shrimp actually are made of these toxins. You know.
I reckon if you put any kind of filth and dirt and whatever into a massive tank of water and put... a shellfish or a lobster or something in it, or one of those creatures in it, within a couple of hours, the water will be clear.
Maybe not that soon, but it would. I've owned many aquariums, and the work that goes into keeping the rocks and sand area clean is a constant thing. Of course, I never had any of those kind of things in there, but I always had fresh water aquariums. But the things become very filthy, and all that dead, decaying matter, all the fecal material, you know, and in the case of the ocean, there's a lot of dying plants and dying animals, and their flesh and so forth is dissolving into the sand. And these creatures, like you say, the clams and the scallops and the shrimp, go in and they clean. They're cleaning the sand of the sea. And then when people come in and grab them and eat them, they're eating toxic things. And then we're wondering why we have cancer and other problems, you know.
Yeah, we learned from Todd Bennett's book on the kosher that it's not a matter of saying that it's not the right food to eat. The principle he was putting forth was that it's not food at all.
That's right.
It's not a matter of saying, well, you shouldn't eat that food. It's like saying, go and eat the leg of the chair. You wouldn't. It's not food.
That's the whole point, yeah. And he says in Leviticus or Wyekra chapter 11, Leviticus 11, that these things that are abominations to us. They are not, and they're an abomination for him to see us eat it. So we have to treat the things as he sees them. It's not going to change, you know, a million years later or 100 years later, or somebody says, oh, everything's changed now. We have refrigeration. You know, that's crazy.
Everything's changed now. It was nailed to the cross.
That too, yeah. Mm. Yeah. And then they misinterpret what Peter was seeing coming down in the four sheets, or was it three sheets?
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. In Acts chapter 10, and then in Acts chapter 11, he explains it. He says, oh, I get it. It was three sheets. And because the three men were going to be at his gate. He wakes up. He's on the roof of his house or the house. And he's the women are down there preparing a meal. And he's having this experience. And he's wondering when he wakes up, I wonder what that meant. Because obviously it wasn't about eating unclean food. But there were three unclean men at the gate inquiring about him because they'd been sent there. And he would not have gone with them because they were Gentiles, but he went with them because the dream or the vision that he had explained to him that it was okay, you know, and that was the whole point. But in most Christian circles, that's not known. They don't know what that means. No, they think it's okay to eat the food now.
Yeah, don't call something that Yahuwah's created unclean. They go with that theory.
Talking about the Gentiles. Yeah. But, yeah, there were three Gentiles and there were three sheets. You know, you have to forgive me. My brain isn't completely awake. I just woke up a while ago. It's late there for you, though, isn't it? They changed the time.
Yeah, we're heading towards midnight.
Wow.
That's okay. Yeah.
Well, hope you all are having a wonderful festival there. This is your first year, and a lot of people.
We've done it for a few years, observed it, but you know, we'd get to the day of the fast, and we'd find out it was like 3 days ago or something, and so you miss it. And this is the first year we've actually consciously tried to. I mean, it's been about 4 or 5 years we've been doing it, but I think with Passover and Shavuot, it's a little bit more easier to grasp the concept of the fulfillments and things. But with the latter feast, it's a bit. And then you've got to, you know, whether you take time off work or whether you don't. For a while there, we were supposed to take off a week, but now we realize it's just the high Sabbaths and just understanding and practicing them, I think. This is the first year, we've been trying to do it really properly with the boys. So,
well, you know, among the Nazarene, there's been a lot of controversy about what day it is, what moon we're supposed to go from, and, you know, even some of the brothers are keeping it a month earlier than this, and they did it already, so it was a month ago for them, and there'll probably be people a month later too. But, you know, these are shadows, and, you know, I noticed that last night that the moon was a little bit past full here, but you have to remember where we are on the earth, because the 24 hours that it takes this festival to go across the planet, it starts out at a certain point. But you see, another thing too is we have to understand that we can't criticize one another over, well, one's keeping it later than another one, a day or two or even three. We understand that there's going to be differences because we're all over the planet. We're scattered. You know, it's like trying to keep the year of every seventh year you're supposed to let the land rest. Well, it's talking about the land. It's not talking about out here where we are. But people don't see that. You know, he said, when you enter the land, then you were to let the land rest.
Your camera's frozen. There you are.
I'm back.
You're back. That's great.
Mm. Yeah. Well, it was probably a UFO or something.
I had people ask me also, still on this topic about praying for dead people, when you pray for people, what if there were family members that you don't think anyway made it based on their life? Is praying for them going to be any help?
What we're really doing is we're praying to the one. We're not praying so much. We know we're not praying to the people, but we know that we're praying for them. We're praying to a being that it would be Yahuwah, that is a being that is in charge of everything, including time. Because, see, time is, to him, a creation. It's an item. It's something that he created. And when we pray to him, we can pray for people in the current time that we live in. Like, for example, when I pray for your family, or you pray for mine, we're praying for the believers. We're praying for the body. And we can also pray for your descendants, the future. We know that. Well, we can pray for the people that lived in the past too. Not that we're praying for them while they're for their condition now, but we're praying for their during their lifetime, because we're praying to the one that is omnitemporal. He's omnipresent too. He's in all space and time and outside space, as we understand it. But it's something that's bigger than our brains can even comprehend. But when I pray for Adam and Kua, then I'm praying for them during their lifetime. But I'm praying to the Creator. You know, that's all that is. And it's just praying for their welfare. It's a way of saying, bless you. I bless you. And I'm wishing you well, you know. And I pray for Abraham. I pray for Hanak. I pray for Methuselah, Lamech, Noah, his family. You can do this because you're praying to the one that is outside time. And all we're saying is, well, you know, when Yahuwah told Abraham, whoever blesses you, I will bless. And whoever curses you, I will curse. So if I pray for Abraham, Yahuwah has put it, it's his word that he will bless the one who blesses Abraham. And of course, Abraham's seed. But I pray for our beloved brother Paul, too. During his lifetime, he had a horrible time. Mm. You know, he was bitten by snakes and stoned. And, you know, it's not like the, you know, and that problem that we're having with our beloved brother Paul, some of the Nazarene and Christians are actually accusing him of being a heretic, as we know. And people are arguing about this and that. And they are now saying that this whole thing started about 6,000 years ago, that there was prophecies about Paul being a heretic. 6,000 years ago? What? You know, and they're just reading this stuff in. And they're saying that things that Yahusha said or things that other writers wrote about were really secretly writing about Paul. They don't identify him. They just talk about, you know, they're interpreting the words and they're just throwing this stuff out, you know. It's just madness.
It's insane.
It is. Yeah. You know. And they were even criticizing Paul because he started his letters out, I, Paul. You know, well, what's the rap on that? You know?
Yeah.
You identify, who you are, like, hi guys, this is Mark or whatever, you know. Yeah. It's not a problem, you know. And he's just giving praise to Yahusha all the time, you know. Mm. You know, but whatever.
Getting back to the Yahuwah existing outside of time, a lot of believers can't wrap their head around, none of us can, but can't wrap their head around the fact that he can do anything. And a lot of the Christians I know, one of the conversations I was having last weekend was the fact that my brother-in-law has a hard time bringing three people into one. Despite all the scriptures, how can he be talking to himself if he's praying to the Father? You know, there must be another person. They don't. And if you believe that when you go, you know, go to heaven, that there'll be three. They think there'll be three beings up there, and they don't realize that all the fullness was in Yahusha. And if you say, oh, when there's heaven, not what we understand, the next kingdom, but if you say there'll just be one. Oh, no. You know, they can't. You're a heretic.
Well, really, there's five of them. No. So silly. Yeah. Well, they see these things and they say, well, it's the Father, the Son, and the Ruach HaKodesh. And they see these three terms. They're all ascribing one being, but they make them into three sort of individual entities. But, you know, one of the first things that I look at is Gabriel's words to Miriam. And, you know, it's like the Ruach HaKodesh is going to overshadow you, and the thing that will be born will be called. It's not something like there's a son already, an offspring of another being that exists that's coming in. He did pre-exist, of course, because he's Yahuwah. But the Father is the Father, and it's just not that hard to understand. But when he's talking to himself, that's, you know, when I talk to myself, I do it when I'm all alone, you know. But I'm not really talking to myself. I talk to Yahusha. I whisper to him. I talk out loud to him. I think to him. You know, he can read our thoughts. You know, he's the only one that can. Even the spatial beings can't read our thoughts. But we can pray. We don't have to move our lips. We can actually speak to him. and he can speak to us, you know, without us saying or doing anything. So we listen to his still small voice all the time and guiding us. And it's not like crazy, but when he talked to himself, he was praying out loud for the benefit of those that were around him, so that he could see that there's a relationship. And the body of what we call the sun was a physical thing, and is a physical thing, that you could feel and touch. And, you know, it had a physical representation. And that was the perfect representation of Yahuwah himself. And that's what Colossians and Philippians is explaining to us. You know, that's the sun, you know. And what was speaking inside that body, you know, inhabiting that body in all its fullness, was the being that we know as Yahuwah. We're supposed to call him Yahusha. He said, whatever you ask, ask in my name. And, you know, we're praying to Yahuwah in the name of Yahusha, because that's the name. He's our deliverer. Yah is our deliverer. And that's the simplicity of it. But when people make it complicated, like, for example, when Calvin, you know, Calvin that lived in Geneva, when Michael Servanus came to town, a traveler, and he had a little slight different take on the Trinity. Well, Calvin said, no, we're going to have three beings. And Michael Servanus says, no, he's one. Well, he was strung up on a steeple and killed, and his body was up there for weeks, you know, letting the birds eat his body, over this dispute about whether or not Yahuwah is three people or three persons. You know, that's not the way we're supposed to treat each other. You know,
in the second last chapter of Todd Bennett's book, The Messiah, we were reading it this week. He was saying that he went to a assembly once, and everybody's got their hands up and they're praising JSUS, and they're singing, "We worship you, you're the only one for me," and they're focusing all this attention on JSUS. And he said, apart from the name being incorrect, he said that when Yahushua was on the earth, he never wanted anything, never wanted any attention. He was always drawing people's attention to the Father. And I thought, that's interesting. I hadn't thought of it like that before. He doesn't want a lot of attention. He was always drawing people's... Would you think he still feels like that? Well, he is the Father.
Yeah. Well, when Philip... let's see. Yeah, Philip was saying, show us the Father. And then he said, Philip, have I been with you so long that you haven't recognized me yet? He who has seen me has seen the Father. And of course, there's other scriptures that seem to be in contradiction with that, that no one has seen the Father. Well, the Father is an eternal, omnitemporal, he's completely unseeable. And yet, this manifestation of Yahusha was, he's there to reveal the Father. And that's what he's done. But when Thomas went down on his knees, he went down and he said, my master and my Elohim. Well, there it is. You know, he's worshiping on his knees before Yahusha. And he's the only one that's, even the messengers that were sent in the scriptures, would make the man get up. We only worship, you know, Yahuwah alone. And Thomas was on his knees before Yahusha, and Yahusha did not say, get up, worship the Father only. He was worshiping the Father that was in Yahusha. That's what he was doing, and Yahusha had no problem with that. You know, we're really segueing into some new, strange places, but yeah, we have our differences of understanding.
Those scriptures that talk about no one has ever seen the Father probably referring to his fullness, like when he said to Moshe, I can't show you my face, you'll just, what did he say?
Oh, yeah.
You'll have to look at the back of my head or something like that.
That's true. Yeah, he would be able to pass briefly with his back to him, and, you know, and he had to do it between two rocks or something, you know, because it was just, you know, he called Abraham his friend, which is really marvelous. He manifested himself in a special way at that time, too, because we have Abraham and Sarah waiting out there in the desert somewhere in a tent. And, you know, they had all their farm animals around them. And, you know, and then these three travelers come along. And one of them happened to be Yahuwah himself, because he came down to the earth. Not necessarily, he says, to see what's going on, but he knows. But the two messengers that were on either side of him are kind of like the Malachim that were represented on the Ark of the Covenant. You know, you have, and you have these two messengers, and obviously they were probably seraphim. You know, the burning ones is what that word means. And these seraphim that were accompanying Yahuwah, Yahuwah went away, and the seraphim, the two seraphim, went into Sodom. You know, and that's pretty amazing, that whole deal. But it wasn't that Abraham was looking at the Father, the Son, and the Ruach HaKodesh, you know. But that's easy for people to read into it, you know.
Do you think that would have been the same, around about the same time as Melchizedek? Do you reckon that was the same manifestation as, because we believe Melchizedek was Yahushua, don't we?
Well, there's some theories, and I'm not going to set that in concrete, but it's said that Melchizedek himself had no father or mother. In other words, he didn't have any origins, apparently, but not in that world. But you see, he couldn't have come through the ark, because Melchizedek wasn't on the ark, you know, unless he was actually one of the sons of Noah, and some have said that he was Shem. Some have said that Melchizedek was actually the priest. He was the oldest of the three brothers, and Shem would have been Melchizedek. Now, that's a theory, but in the book of Hebrews, it seems to lean towards the idea that it was actually Yahuwah himself, you know, and he was manifesting himself as the order of Melchizedek. Before the Levitical priesthood existed, the original priesthood was, he would be the head of it, so he'd be the high priest. And the high priest of the Melchizedek priesthood right now is Yahushua. So who would that be? And I lean towards the idea that Melchizedek, the man that Abraham tithed to, was the same being that we honor as Yahushua now. Because the high priest does not, that's the difference between the Melchizedek priesthood and the Levitical priesthood, is that the high priest doesn't die, and, you know, and that's the limit, one of the main limiting problems of the Levitical priesthood. The high priest kept dying, you know. And now we have a permanent high priest, and in fact, I think the original high priest, you know. But it was before he was born, so it was Yahuwah himself, you know. I mean, who would be the head of the priesthood? Well, you know, obviously it would be Yahuwah, an eternal being.
Well, Scripture says he's the head, isn't it?
Yes.
Where the body.
And we're just the, he calls us branches and descendants of his teachings. We're always trying to wrap our arms around this, and it's really, really difficult to do. And we just have to say, you know, we don't really know, but we know the one that does know. And just acknowledge that, and not start stringing each other up on steeples. And
exactly.
Or speaking against one another, and just say, well, you know, you only have 46 chromosomes. I have 243, you know.
How's that fern going?
I don't know. Oh, by the way, it reminds me of the greenery. We just get light little branches when we put them up. And Adam put some screen up on top of our sukkah, which it's a structure that we have as permanent, actually, out on the back. And it's just a frame. And then when he put some screen, like the kind of screen you put in a door for mosquitoes, and he stapled it on there. And you just sort of tie little fronds of, you know, leafy trees so that over the 7 days of Sukkoth, you can notice that they're starting to dry out, and eventually the leaves will just start falling off and getting really old and dried out, just like our bodies do. Over the 7 days, it kind of represents the 70 years of a normal lifespan. And I'm 61 now, so I'm one of those dried out leaves now. And but you see, the whole point of Sukkah, the Sukkoth, is that this is a temporary dwelling that we live in. This is not our home. And then when we get sick, we go, well, is this the one? Is this where we're going to go? You know, or if we have an accident. Well, we know that this is not, we don't have to fear, because it's when we observe Sukkah or Sukkoth, we have a yearly reminder that this body, this tent, is not our own, is not our home. This is a temporary dwelling, and we're just sojourners. We're travelers. We're in the world, and we're not home yet, you know. But what dwells in us, though, is a very special treasure. And that treasure is, of course, the thing that he's given life to. And that life is going to go on and on and on. And that's another issue people have. They say, immortality is a pagan concept. What? Where'd the pagans get it? Well, see, some of the things pagans believe are actually true. You know, not everything they believe is error. And it didn't come from them. It was just inherited by them, because they knew about Yahuwah. You know, like the woman that was in Jericho that helped the two spies. She knew about the name Yahuwah. She actually spoke the name. She said, we're moon worshippers over here, but we know that you're the servants of Yahuwah, the Most High. So she knew, you know. The pagans know. The witches know. They're just in rebellion.
The witches know more about it than the Christians do.
Very much so.
Yeah.
That's bizarre. But it's a choice, you know, they made. And the Christians are in a kind of like a box. The people will not go outside their little, you know, phrases and their concepts. You need to say, wait a minute, this is Greek? Yeah, it's Greek. And it went into Latin, and then now it's more corrupt than ever. And now we're speaking English. We don't want to speak that Hebrew. Well, why not? You know, this is what, I mean, there's no way that the Messiah's name was Jehoshaphat. Yeah. You know.
Oh, you're just a legalist.
Oh, is that it? Well, we actually love the truth, is what it is. It's the ones that receive a love for the truth that are delivered, and the ones that refuse to receive a love for the truth, whoops, you know.
Yeah, my dad said that to me. He said, that's getting into a bit, we think that's a bit legalism. I said, well, Dad, if I said that to the police officer when he pulled me over, I don't want to do that. That's a bit legalistic. He'd throw me in jail.
You know? Exactly. Yeah, they got this term that is completely outside Scripture. And lawlessness is what they promote. And they're saying it by accusing you of loving to obey. You know, the love of obedience is not of us. It's something that Yahusha changed us. He wrote a love for his Torah on our hearts, so that we actually are looking for ways to please him. Not for our salvation, though. It's because we're married to him. We're his bride. Yeah. You know, why wouldn't we want to obey our husband? You know?
Yeah.
Oh, he obeyed that for me. He did this. He kept Sabbath. I don't have to now, because he already did that for me. You know,
he's the master of the Sabbath now.
Yeah, well, he always is, always what, always will be. I think it's, Zechariah 14, we mentioned earlier. He says from new moon to new moon and from Sabbath to Sabbath. And he's not saying so much on those days. He's saying from and to. So it's the entire span of time. All flesh will come and bow down before him and worship him. Do obeisance, or obed is the Hebrew word. Obey. Obed is the Hebrew word for worship. And it means to bow. And it also literally means that we're to worship and obey. That's where we get our word obey. It comes from the Hebrew word obed. Mm. You know, so.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to show off. It's just that's the fact. You know?
Yeah.
So you're trying to obey to get salvation. And no, that salvation is in the blood of the Messiah. We trust in his sacrifice, his offering of his blood for our vileness and our incomplete and sinful nature. And by changing us, our obedience is actually evidence that we have been delivered. That's the evidence. It's like his brother James, Jacob, said that, you know, you show me your faith or your emunah by what you believe, and I'll show you my faith by what I do. Because if you don't obey, what good is it without works? If you don't have the evidence, you know. See, they're misinterpreting Ephesians chapter 2. When they read all the way through, though, they see that these things were meant for us to walk in these ways. You know, the Torah, the instructions are for us to walk in. And that's why it's so exciting to see people that are coming back into the festivals, like people like yourself and thousands of other people around the world that are hearing about things like Sukkoth. And they're going, what is that? Well, Messiah was born on the first day of Sukkoth, in the seventh month of the Hebrew calendar. And it also is, you know, that's what they were in when Miriam and Yosef were in this stable. That was a sukkah. It was a temporary dwelling. Animals were in it, you know, but it was not a permanent structure. And then we also have the understanding of a sukkah being a household or a tent that Israel had to live in for dozens of years in the wilderness, 40 years, I believe. And, you know, those are all manifestations of this same time to remember that. And then also it looks forward to the wedding festival, and going into the household is when the bride is taken into the house, is reflected in every Jewish wedding where they get under the kippah. And the kippah is a sukkah, you know. It's a household, a tent that is temporary, and that, of course, all goes back to the fact that our bodies are temporary tents, you know, temporary dwellings, and we're just sojourners, and it all connects. But the seventh month festivals are shadows that we're doing right now of the actual time that the bride, this will be the day in some future year when Yahushua takes us into the New Jerusalem, and we're assembled together as his bride. And we don't know what it's going to look like, but it's going to be amazing. And it's not so much a building. We're the building. We're the living stones, you know. Wow. And, you know, like there's all kinds of figurative and physical things in the Hebrew language, as we talk about a lot. The seat of Moshe, for example, you know, it's a chair. But it really isn't talking about a chair. It's talking about an office. You know, like, for example, we're supposed to, when we hear the scribes and the Pharisees or the people that read the Torah, we're supposed to do everything that they say, you know, because they're the older brethren. Everything that they say, we are to do and obey. But we're not supposed to do as they do, but because they sit in the seat of Moshe, you know, that's their office. So when they're reading the Torah, or the five books of Moshe, then we're to do everything that they say, you know. That's because they're reading from that office, you know. But Gentiles and Ephraim in general, the scattered tribes, we've been living in rebellion for so long that it's hard for all of us together to come into a teamwork effort and say, what's the older brother saying? Let's listen to him, because the older brother knows things. He knows how to do things that we have been, that are foreign to us, you know, like Sukkoth and Passover, you know, that all of these things are shadows of things that were to come, and now they're being understood. you know, and Ephraim's getting all kinds of arguments about the moon, and oh, you're a month early, and well, what's the older brother doing? You know, he's sitting in the seat of Moshe. Now, if he's in error, and we are still following the older brother, and we say, well, the older brother, some details of the older brother, they're errant because they don't have the Messiah. Things like the 3 days and three nights, the sign of Jonah. They don't even know what that is. In fact, they don't even know what the festivals themselves actually represent. They don't know that they're shadows of things that are coming or fulfillments of the deliverance. They're nothing we have to do anyway. It's all about Messiah and his activity because we don't have to really do anything on a festival. It's a matter of us observing what Yahusha has done or is going to do so that we're, you know, understanding the redemptive idea of every festival, you know. But it's all about his bride. Sukkoth is all about the bride. It was about his birth and circumcision, because the first day he was born, the eighth day, you know, he was circumcised. And it has to do with the Torah. You know, circumcision has to do with the Torah. And the eighth day of Sukkoth, or the seventh day of Sukkoth, and then the last great day is called Simchat Torah, the joy of Torah. And that reflects back to his circumcision, you know, the covenant. You know, see, the word circumcision in Hebrew is brit, which means to cut. And it's talking about circumcision. And our hearts have been cut by him. See, he circumcised our hearts. And that cutting, we could feel it when it happened. And we died, in a sense, because we went, ah, I love the Torah. And you feel this joy for knowing there's a Torah. You know, that's what happens to people when they're converted. And that's what Simchat Torah is pointing to in 8 days from now. I think it's this day next week.
Yeah, we'll be having some joy that day.
That's right. The world to come represents the 1,000 years of rest. That's the world to come, you know. And, of course, there'll be a new heavens and new earth it talks about, too, after that 7,000th year. But, you know, it's all basically a big picture of a huge week, you know. It's 7,000 years, you know. And during that time of that 7,000 years, that Sabbath of rest from the dragon and the fallen Malachim, we're going to be just having such a good time. We're going to just be so joyful, you know. And that's going to be like a huge festival. You know, Israel hadn't celebrated or observed Sukkoth for hundreds and hundreds of years. And then there was a reading of the Torah, you know, under a king. And the king had, somebody found a scroll in the ruins of the temple and said, look what we found here. And he said, well, read a little bit of that for me. And they read it, they were just blown away by what they found. Of course, the king was shocked, and he ripped his robes. He went, we haven't obeyed this. And then, and so he goes, we've got to read this to the people. And then they celebrated Sukkot for the first time in hundreds of years. And it was the most incredible party. It just went on and on and on. You know, but do you all have a festival like we do called Thanksgiving?
It's not a big thing over here, Thanksgiving.
Okay.
But, is Thanksgiving and Hanukkah the same thing?
No, not at all.
No, I'm not sure. No, we don't do Thanksgiving. A lot of people over here don't even do Hanukkah. It's more than just for the Jews, you know.
Yeah.
In fact, only recent years we've actually known what Hanukkah was. Most of it you just see in movies what it was about. Those things aren't big over here.
For Christians that don't know it, Hanukkah is mentioned in as the Feast of the Dedication, which is what Hanukkah means, dedication or rededication of the temple. And it was actually after Antiochus Epiphanes in 186 BCE was, you know, overcome, and the Maccabees and the people, they took the land back over and they started to clean up the temple again. Well, that was that was mentioned in John chapter 10, I believe it is. We call him Yehuchanan. In John chapter 10, during the Feast of Dedication. So it is something that we can be sure of, that if it hadn't have been, if the Maccabees had not been successful, and there would have been no Hanukkah, original dedication of the temple, then what would be the outcome from that? Because this is a very important thing. It isn't anything but a civil observance. It isn't something that we are obliged to do by Torah. But remembering it is like a civil holiday or special day. And I wouldn't even want to use the word holiday, really. But it's a remembrance, you know, of something that happened. And it's more civil. You know, it's not a spiritual thing. But it does have spiritual ramifications, because it was going on in Yahusha's time. It's mentioned in the book of Yehuchanan or John.
So what's Thanksgiving to you Americans? Something to do with Indians and pilgrims or something, isn't it?
Well, there's been a lot of mix-up about that over the years, but Thanksgiving is understood today as involving, you know, the pilgrims that first came here, arriving in around 1492, and then the Native Americans. They had a lot of deaths because of that first winter and the second winter, and some subsequent year after that, the Native Americans were so helpful sharing food with the survivors that they had this, you know, party or harvest festival, you know. And of course, there are a lot of people that won't observe it because they are fearful that it might be offensive to Yahuwah. But it may have been that the Native Americans did this anyway because they were scattered tribes of Israel. And they serve succotash, you know, this mix of various plants, corn and things. They call it maize here in this country, the Native Americans. And a lot of Nazarene are fearful that by observing Thanksgiving that they're doing something evil. Then again, you know, it's not being done it as an observance of anything, you know, spiritual at all. But it could be that it was done by the Native Americans because it was during this time of year when Sukkoth was going on. And that's a theory, but the people that in subsequent years, like in the 1700s, like Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin and George Washington and those gents, what they did was they recognized that the Native Americans were descendants of Israel. They saw what they were like, and they said, these are very strange, unique people. You know, they were migratory, they had temporary dwellings, and they spoke a language that Thomas Jefferson was well-versed in many languages, and he recognized some of the words. And they in their writings, they say they identified these people as the scattered tribes. And they knew more about it than we do today. Not that they were Jews. There may have been some mixed in there, but they were other tribes like Zebulun and Ephraim and, you know, Dan. We've talked about Dan in other episodes.
I'd say Thanksgiving would be very similar to Australia Day for us. That's the celebration of Captain Cook discovering Australia, 17, I don't know. We don't even know our own history. But that's on Jan 26th every year.
Really? Well, is there a place there called Botany Bay?
Yes, that's where he landed.
Well, there you go.
Yeah. So the friction that... with the Indians, with you guys, probably be with the Aboriginals, with us, when he first came, there was a lot of slaughtering and stolen generations and things like that.
Really? So, you know, the Native Americans at first were friendly, you know, to the pilgrims. They were not having a problem, but they had a little different encounter with the Spanish. The Spanish were bringing a little more violence to the picture, but... you know, the white man kept pushing the red man back and back and pushing him off his land. Then there was some resistance and, you know, a lot of unhappiness. But yeah, it's like similar, I guess, to what your country had to go through. But the people that were already there were basically ignored and persecuted, you know. But they were living simple lives and obviously very happy. But of course, they did need to hear the truth. And, you know, and through all the turmoil, the civilized areas were carrying the true message, even though it was horribly corrupted, you know. But, you know.
1788.
There you go.
There you go. Yeah.
Well, you know, all this is a time of, there was a time what we call the period of colonization. And it went on from basically the 1300s through, you know, the 1700s. And new lands were being discovered, but there were already people there, so how could they be discovered? But they like to beat their chest and say, I found it, you know, and actually there are people already here, you know, so what's going on with that, you know? You're some foreigner yourself, and you're claiming that you found this, you know? History is just a mess, you know. It's written by the conquerors.
Yeah. As you're going a bit red now, so that must be the same lighting that you normally get.
Oh, boy. Yeah, it might be the lighting here. Ah. I don't have any red lights on, but my shirt looks red.
Yeah. Oh, that's right, too. We had all those discussions today about my daughter's name.
Oh, yes.
And I just talked to Amy about it, and because in the beginning, because she was upset, it'll be a different person, you know. We're getting used to her as this name. I said, well, we could call her by her middle name if you want. Her middle name's Charlotte. That just means man, apparently. And but she didn't really like that. I said, well, why don't you just stick with Bella, or something like that.
Oh, that's the problem, though. See, it's not the first part of the name. It's the last part of the name that has the problem.
Oh, okay.
So yeah.
Bella part.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, if you called her Bella, if you just said Bella, that would be an Italian name for beautiful.
So, Bella. Mm-hmm. Lovely. Yeah, we'll do that.
There was a, and then it wouldn't be associated at all with the other word, because when you put them together, then it's hard to not associate. But
because then when you were saying, because we read that email a few times, I said, it doesn't sound like you were saying that the name itself was a deity, but that particular person was a super witch.
Yeah.
And so then Amy was saying, well, if we were to call her, if we crossed out every name from somebody who was into witchcraft, the whole world is into witchcraft. So she was coming at it from that angle. So we can't use any name. And I said, yeah, but she was a super witch.
Yep.
And of course, we always used to say, call her by the J-E-Z, you know, when we were when we were in the assembly. So I said, well, would you call her that name? She said, no. I said, well, it's the same name. There was no letter J. There was no J-E-Z-E-B-E-L. There was no, it was I-Z-E-B. That was her name. Yeah, of course, we didn't know that. So we'll just stick with Bella. That's nice.
Well, when I first heard that you named her Isabella, you know, like I said in the email, it sounded to me like you were, well, the first word Isa is really Isha, which means woman. And then, of course, you know, the last part was the problem. B-E-L was referring to the deity, you know. Yeah. So if you did name her Bela or Bella, you still have that component in there, you know. Yeah. But we're talking about the Italian word, beautiful, you know.
Did you say it was a Hebrew word or is it an Italian word?
Italian, but it may be derived from the Hebrew word B-E-L or B-A-A-L, and I'm not sure. Now, the B-A-A-L word as a pronoun isn't evil at all. It's only when it's a proper name that it becomes a problem. The proper name, B-A-A-L, is actually a deity, But the word Baal in Hebrew is just a word that means husband or master, Lord, that kind of thing, you know. But when you use it as a proper name, then bam, it's illegal, you know. Mm. And people a lot of times don't use it at all.
But the scriptures that we would have would not use it as what was the word? A verb? It would only be using it as a proper noun, wouldn't it?
Yeah, a proper noun is a name. But a pronoun would just be what it is, you know. It's
So it wouldn't use it in that sense, would it? Because it's not written in Hebrew, it's written in English.
I don't know. I would probably recommend, if you were disturbed about it at all, that's the part of the name that's the problem. If you named her Ishi or Isha, see, the word Isha is a part of the name. It's really not Isha, it's Isha.
Yeah.
If that's what it means. It means woman, you know. So if you just named your little girl Isha, that would just be a Hebrew word for woman.
Yeah.
Be a little better than naming her Charlotte, because that means man.
That's it.
So if you named her Isha Charlotte, it would be woman man.
That's what Amy was saying. We're calling her a man / woman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's, well, you all didn't maybe know what Charlotte meant, right?
No, not at all.
Yeah, yeah.
And,
well, you know, that's the nice thing about it. See, it's sometimes, I guess, there were, we know there were name changes. You know, people took on different names. In fact, Kepha was known as Shimon, or Simon, as we call him today. But Shimon, Kepha,
yeah.
Peter, you know, he had three names, you know.
Yeah, that's what I said too. I said they people change their names all the time in the scripture. It's not a big deal.
But you're the parents, and you have the authority to change the names.
Yes.
See, I never really got how people could change their own name, because it takes somebody that's over them to do that. But if Yahushua renames you, you know, that's fine. You know? Mm. But if you want to take on an alias, that's, I guess, okay. But and I don't know who named Paul, you know, but...
Well, we figured we would just leave the birth certificate as is and just call him by a different name, because lots of people have names that aren't really on their birth certificate. Because Lou's not your name, is it?
Lou is in my middle name. Yeah, it's Lewis. It's Lewis.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that's my middle name. And that was to disassociate me from my dad, so that, you see, he named me the same name he has and made Junior. You know, so it's Arthur Lewis White Jr., and his name is Arthur Lewis White, and his name Arthur comes from the Hebrew word Aharon, which means mountain, and anglicized into the word Arthur, and he was known as Art, so they didn't want to have to say Art, and then both of us show up, so they, so what they did was they continued to call him Art, and they called me Lou, you know.
Yeah.
And people have said, well, that can't possibly be your real name, you know. And they accuse me of all kinds of things about my hair, too. They say, what's going on with your hair? Do you dye your hair? No, I've got 7 colors of hair, you know. And it confuses people, you know. It's really what it is, you know. It's just weird the way this is white and this is some other color, you know. Kind of an auburn or brown, you know, blonde mixed in, you know.
Yeah.
It's, I'm just a freak. But, you know, the thing of it is, though, these names mean things, and whatever you all decide to do, it isn't really difficult to change that, you know.
No.
I don't think you have to worry, because whatever she's named, as long as you and your wife love the name that you choose, it won't be a different person. It'll just be like you just opened a little gift and said, what was hiding in this little person? You know, this name was always there, you know, just treat it like that. Because whatever you name her will have a meaning, you know, to you. Whereas you probably looked at the meaning of the name Isabella, and I saw something. But you see, a lot of times those people don't go back far enough. They're just shallow, you know, and then they don't go back to the real derivation of the name, you know.
Yeah.
But
well, we spent 9 months, actually. We were going to call her Aaliyah, which when I looked it up this morning on the Hebrew name,
yeah,
spelt with an E-L-I-Y-A-H. I thought it's got L and it's got Yah in it. I wonder, yeah, if that, I wonder if that would be kind of a Yahuwah is Elohim kind of scenario.
Absolutely.
That'd be quite, yeah, quite a statement.
Oh, it would be wonderful, yeah.
Of course, we used to like it spelt with the double A at the front, with the, you know, like that rock star that used to be Aaliyah. Do you have any over there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You could certainly do that, and it wouldn't matter because the first letter in the word L is an aleph. It's an A, you know. You know, in fact, the word that they use for the deity of the Islamic people is the Hebrew word. It's just a term. It's just spelled with a more accurate letter, actually. You know, but the pronunciation is the same. It's just a short, you know, a short form of Elohim, you know. But it does, it's used as a proper noun, so it's illegal for us. But it doesn't make the word Ella or Allah, the word in Hebrew that means mighty one or strong one or strength, illegal. But the word is also adapted in the Hebrew to mean a curse. Did you know that? The word... In Hebrew, the word A-L-A-H is actually defined in two ways. It has two meanings. One is, it means mighty one, and the other definition is a curse. Now, they're not associated, but they're spelled the same way. And so, it's kind of funny, because in the phrase that a lot of the Islamic people say, the word Akbar is involved. They say the name of their deity, and then they say Akbar. And in Hebrew, Ak, you know, it means a mouse or a rat. And, you know, and then Bar means son. So you've got son of mouse, you know, Akbar. Son of, and it, but that isn't what it means in Arabic, you know. But, there's a lot of language problems, but most of the Arabic, I think overwhelming amounts of it are actually derived from Hebrew. You know, after all, Ishmael is a descendant of Abraham. You know,
yes.
You know, the people that in subsequent years, like in the 1700s, like Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin and George Washington and those gents, you know, after all, Ishmael is a descendant of Abraham, you know.
Yes.
You know, so, you know, I'm not prone to, in my heart, despise any of the descendants of Abraham because of the fact that they came from Ishmael. It's just that they've been taught the wrong things. It's just like any other false belief system. It's just a sad thing that violence is an outcome, and it's something that is not intended. You know, Yahuwah didn't want violence on the earth. I mean, that's not what his teachings are, you know. But that's the product of a lot of these faith groups. So, you know, you look at the fruit, and you can identify the tree by the fruit that you see. And when you see fruit that's not good, then you just simply say, well, that must be a bad tree. You know, a tree can be a metaphor for a faith group or a religion, you know. I mean, it's not like we're condemning anybody personally. It's just that you can, you know, take on, you know, bad fruit, and then then you start spreading that into the world. And one of the funny things, I don't mean to make fun of Islam at all, because I have theories about, you know, in my research where it started, but there was a a little scene that I had in my head where, you know, somebody like you or me was being evangelized by an Islamist, and the Islamist is explaining their faith to us, and then we go, well, let me get this straight. Let's see, there's 10% are Sunnis who believe they're descended from Muhammad's family, and then 90% are Shia or Shiites, and they're mad at each other, you know, over, you know, who's in charge or whatever, and they're killing each other. So if I convert to Sunni Islam, what I have to do is I have to go to Mecca and walk around in circles and then fear for my life by 90% of the other people who believe the same thing I do. Who can resist that? You know, I'm not making fun of it. I'm just saying that this is kind of like reality, though. You know, it's a weird scenario, but I think very true. So if you convert to the other one, then only 10% of the people are trying to kill you. You know.
Wow.
So you better pick Shiite.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding. I don't want to walk around in circles. You know, the Shintos do that. Yeah. They're pagodas. They're shrines. You know. Remember that song that you, well, I guess we co-wrote it. The one about the wormwood?
Yeah. I once had a shrine.
Yeah. Wow. That was another one. I bet you lost sleep on that one, too. That was amazing.
Yeah, that was interesting, that one.
Yes,
that was the one with you. That was the one with you with the cartoon playing the sitar.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
Teaching the donkey how to play.
My fingers are still sore. That's amazing. I didn't look like myself very much, but well, you had a lot of fun though with those things. I mean, we're all just amazed at what you did, and it's just unbelievable. I mean, this stuff, it would seem like it would take at least weeks, and yet you pull this stuff off in days, you know.
Yeah, it's insane.
Well, I told Adam that you have a lot of experience with, you know, this kind of thing anyway. You know, from the circus, you know.
Yeah. And I think when you're not doing it with live instruments, trying to stick to a metronome or tap your foot or whatever, it's a bit different to when everything's... See, my keyboard here, even if I was slightly off, it pushes everything into sync. So it's like computer sync, so it's the same speed and you don't have anything out of beat or out of time, and it's an old thing, and some of the buttons are starting to wear and everything, but it's still plodding along, so I stick to it.
Yeah. Well, if you're familiar with it, you got to stick with it, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we better call it a day because it's, oh my, we've been really recording a lot.
Yeah, we'll have some heavy editing this weekend.
Yeah. Well, you know, let me know how you do with your daughter's name. I'd like to hear more about that.
Yeah.
You know, but...
Well, I think if we were to stick with something that was similar, I think she'd either go, I didn't mind what you were saying about Isha, that was nice, or I think she liked, I think she likes Isha better than what I was saying, which was Bella.
Yeah, so, yeah. Hmm. Well, if you were to go with one or the other, you'd probably want to get as far away from Bella as you could because of the possibility that there could be an association made, because of, through that name, Isabella. There is an association, so we would probably be better to choose Isha, you know. But I like the, what was it, Ayla?
Aaliyah.
Aaliyah. Mm. Aaliyah is a very beautiful name. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll run it by the boss.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well. You guys have a wonderful rest of the day. I guess it's over now, but it's ended for you. Yeah. The first day is still going on here.
Yeah.
That's the thing about this planet, you know.
Yeah. Hey, gone, sister.
Hey.
There she is.
I wish Lou would keep his camera on, then I could see if I'm in the picture or not.
Yeah. Can you see her?
I can. Yeah. Well, see, that wouldn't matter because... what I can see of myself, my head's chopped off, but I'm sure you can see a lot more of my So my screen, from what I can see, ends here.
Oh, my.
Really?
So, and my screen ends here.
Yeah.
And here.
Uh-oh. Yeah.
But when I watch it back, I've got heaps of room everywhere.
So
I could see Phyllis on the side where she probably couldn't see herself.
Oh, okay.
That's amazing.
Sorry?
It's good seeing you.
Yeah, you too. Yeah.
Well, we'll get together next week then.
Yeah,
okay.
Next week. Beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah. Tell Amy
love you guys.
Give Amy my love.
I will.
Okay.
Love you guys. Have a good
love
day.
Bye bye now.
Bye bye. Talk. Talk. I said little.